today we got to play Tapestry.
With the Plans and Ploys expansion. This is the first expansion, not the new one that's coming out.
We're excited about the new one.
Yeah.
We'll be reviewing that.
I might be getting that from Cricket for Christmas.
You might be.
Well, considering Robert said I was getting it for Christmas, I'm pretty sure I'm getting it for Christmas.
So, high likelihood. High likelihood. We miss Robert. Robert hasn't been in one of these forever.
I know.
You should harass Robert down below.
Yeah.
But before we get started, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and the notification bell because board games are awesome and that's what we do here. So, tell us more about Tapestry.
So, Tapestry is a 2019 release. Mm-hmm. The Plans and Ploys expansion was a 2020 release, so it came out a year apart. Mm-hmm. The Board Game Geek rating for just Tapestry alone is 7.5, and the rank is 243.
Oh, so that's pretty high.
It plays 1 to 5 players. Average length of game is 90 to 120 minutes, and age is 12 and up. It's designed by Jamie Stegmeier with art by Andrew Bosley and Rom Brown. Published by Stonemeyer Games. The MSRP on just Tapestry alone is pricey. It's $99. But you do get a lot of neat painted miniatures.
Yeah, that's
but
true.
Still, $99 is pretty high. But
we'll talk about it in component quality.
Yeah, on Card House, it sells for $64.99. So it is out there for...
More reasonable price. $64, very reasonable. Like, I can get behind $64.
Yeah, the expansion is a $30 MSRP, and I just found that on Card House for $25.49. So, it's roughly, if you're wanting both, which I highly recommend if you are interested in Tapestry, which we'll get to later, then it's $85.50 roughly for both.
Yeah. All right, so let's talk about quality of pieces. So... I love the little houses, the other civilization buildings that you can kind of get are really cool. It's really pretty on the map. The cubes are not wooden cubes, they're plastic for some reason. I don't know, it just feels better with this game. Also, your military units, I also like their, it's not plastic, it's one of the like rubber
the resin, yeah. They look like little TARDISes from if you've watch Doctor Who.
So, no, these are actually pretty cool. So I actually like the component quality for this. What are your thoughts?
I like the fact that all the cards are for the different factions are textured.
As well as the actual player board itself is textured.
Yeah, the player board's textured. I love all the figures, the miniatures. The board, it creases, doesn't crease right. It's like it doesn't set. Yeah, it's about the only grievance. Apart from, the only other grievance would be the bases on the different things.
Well, they do have 3D printed fixes for those.
Yeah, but they don't come in the game, so.
Right. Well, I'm just saying, for people that are annoyed by it, they can buy the STLs files, which I've done. I just haven't printed them.
So the issue with it is you're using these to cover up spaces on your board, and they don't fill the spaces correctly. So it's sometimes
kind of
a little hard to tell exactly how many spaces it should take up.
Yeah, the small ones are fine, because they're really spot on as far as size, but those odd-shaped buildings... That can get a little more difficult than, what is that supposed to cover? So, I agree with you on that fact, but let's talk about scoring.
All right, so overall, I'm probably going to go ahead and give it a 9. I mean,
I agree.
Most of the components are pretty amazing.
Yeah, I agree with that one. There's a lot of good quality here. Nothing feels outright chintzy. It's a bummer that the board is warped.
Yeah.
And we haven't played this game too much, sadly, to my despair. But we're all pretty good. All right, so now let's talk about theme. So the theme is you're building a civilization. You have civilization, and you're building it up through the different technology tracks, as well as your capital city, which is in your board. You do have a conquering, exploration and conquering kind of action thing going on as well. I will say, yes, the component quality is really, really nice. Theme driven, though,
it's not horribly
strong on this.
The game itself is misleading because the name says Tapestry, a civilization game. This is not a Civilization game.
It's not.
This is a little bit of area control, mostly a track building game.
Which I mean, I'm fine with.
Yeah. Oh no, there's absolutely nothing. When I first heard about this game, I was super stoked because every aspect of the things I like is in this game. And I, if there's ever a game that was made for me, it was supposed to be this game. We'll get to why that didn't quite hit the mark.
Well, you know, we all have differences of opinion.
Yeah.
All right. So, I don't think the themes heavy on this one.
I don't either.
I mean, the pieces are great. It leads to the theme, but not really because it's like, at the beginning, okay, you're the maker of fire. That all makes sense. But then I'm in the industrial age. But then I go back and do manifest. Like, I'm bouncing around.
It's not sequenced.
It's not sequenced. So that's, you know, and you're exploring ish, but it's really about going up tracks.
It's definitely area control, track building, variable player powers, big on variable player powers.
Yeah. So, but the theme I don't think is very strong.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to give theme a 6.
I'm going to go a little higher, give it a 7. I think the iconography is really good.
I like the art
on all the different factions
That's right, too.
So I'm going to give it a 7. I think,
you say that, and I almost forgot that art is in this component. And it does have really good art. And then iconography is spot on. So whoever did the designing art thing for that, top notch on that one. Easy to read, really straightforward to understand. I appreciate it. So now let's talk about rules. So this is actually the third or fourth time we've played this.
I think fourth. So the main rule book, when you buy the game, is only 4 pages long. And for as complex, I mean, it's not super complex game, but for the level of complexity of this game, 4 pages is pretty amazing that they were able to get it down to 4 pages and make it understandable.
Right. Well, I mean, in reality, so we had a new guy. We had a new visitor. He was new to us, which is, I always like meeting new people. So he actually got to play with us, which was really great. But when explaining to him, it was like, all right, you're going up 4 tracks. You have 4 choices every round, you know. So in that aspect, it was, I mean, but there's a lot of complexity to figuring out how to manage all the tracks.
Yeah.
But still, it's straightforward enough to teach people.
To get this many different components to a game into a 4-page rule book is impressive. And to make it easy to understand and clear. Now, what isn't in this 4 pages is explained on the reference sheet are what all the iconography are. And that, you know, that and all the cards. And those are all done on one big page. Problem is, you need this a lot. And it takes up a lot of real estate. And the game takes up a lot of real estate. We did not play this game on this game table. There is no way. We played it 4 player and barely got it to fit on our dining room table, which is probably about a third larger than this.
Yeah,
table.
We would have had to have auxiliary tables to play this game here.
Yeah, and then, you know,
Every player would have had their own, right.
Ideally, we'd have to play it down on the pool table downstairs, which means, you know, it's just something to note. If you don't have a big table, this is probably not the game for you. But especially since
very sad.
You need these reference cards out, and they are huge. They're the same size as the rule book and the box. So you're going to need, there's 2 of these in the box that you can pass around. Now, the rule book for the expansion is much smaller. Obviously, it's the size of the box, and it's smaller. Actually, it's less than the size of the box. And it also is 4 pages long, but there's not as much detail because there's really all the expansion adds is starting buildings to give you a little boost at the beginning and some basically some new tiles and some new civilizations. And then the most important thing is the corrections for the first game, which we'll get to here in a little bit.
Let's talk about it now. Because this is kind of rules.
All right.
It is rules. Okay. So the biggest, I'm going to give a little jump in ahead of the thing. I really, really enjoy this game. However, there is some serious balancing issues based on the civilizations that get chosen. it's bad, guys.
Yes, there it's are bad. A couple, if not several, factions that are way overpowered, and yeah. some that are way underpowered.
Correct.
Now, there was an effort put in the expansion, no less. Not in, they didn't do a retro for the base game, but for the expansion, they added in the adjustments to make. But even with the adjustments, some of the factions are still way overpowered. It helped.
Well, I think they got close.
Yeah.
Except for the Futurist.
Yeah, the Futurist is, yeah, you basically just remove it from the game. Because if you have someone with the Futurist, they're going to win.
I mean, unless they're brand new, never played. Yeah. Maybe you give them as a boon because everyone else is like, oh, everyone else has played this a couple times. We feel sorry for that person here, have the best faction. They'll still win, but, you know, at least they'll feel good and want to come play again. So there's that piece.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's frustrating because this is where my frustration with variable player powers started. Because I like the concept of it. I like when it's executed well. But because it feels good to have this really uber-powerful ability, and everybody else have their own uber-powerful abilities, which they did that better in Marco Polo. But,
right, I agree.
But in even there's some balance issues, but not nearly to the extent
of
this game.
Not nearly as bad.
This one, it killed the game for me. I mean, I really wanted to love this game. And because of that, and the fact that somebody at the table refused to take the Futurist out of the game when we played.
It wasn't me.
No, I'm not looking at you. I'm looking at the person who's not with us today, who always tends to get it when we do the draw. And,
yeah, I mean, the thing is I know it killed it for you, but, and I guess we're kind of verging kind of a little bit into play, gameplay, though, with it, is that it's still a lot of fun.
I enjoyed it more this playthrough, because we did take Futurist out, and we did have better balance on the team thing. I still think mine might have been better powered than yours, but mine was not one that they adjusted.
Yours was pretty powerful, and it was actually kind of annoying.
So, I mean, that's the thing, is I still don't think they've really affixed all of the problems with the original game. Because the Militants were part of the original game. And they introduced new factions, and I'm not sure all those are now balanced. So, you know, this whole thing, we're going to keep introducing new factions with the new expansions, and if we don't balance those correctly, then we're going to have the next expansion having the balancing stuff for the plans and ploys, and are we going to have this chain of bad balanced characters?
You know, I feel like it's like World of Warcraft updates when it first started. Like, one class would get super powerful, and then they would have to mitigate. And it's like, all right, every time there was an update, it's like, they better not murph my whatever, you know, whatever it was. No, I think this should go to rules because of the structure for the game is a little unbalanced. And because of that, I think it should be placed in.
Well, I don't think it's the structure of the game. I think it is the variable player powers exclusively.
Right, specifically.
That is where the balancing issue is. And it's frustrating because it could have been such a good game otherwise.
I still love the
mechanics of it. That really ruins a game when you have runaway, you know, characters. And
it does. I mean, the income that you got every round was, it was killer. It was killer. Like, I got to activate an extra space.
I think Kevin had a pretty good ability with his, too.
Which is, so mine basically sucked.
Well, I'm saying, there's still issues with it. And that's the thing, is when you, this is the bad thing. Even if there weren't, even if it wasn't balance issues now, because you know they exist in the game, it could be, they could be perfectly fixed now. But we would still play it. And if somebody got an edge because they perform better in the game or anything, now it's going to be, your power was better than mine. That's what it set. It set that precedent because it did have problems. So now, every game, the people who were not winning are going to feel like their character is less powerful than the people who are winning. And whether it really is or not, because of that.
That's true. I mean, and then some people play certain powers better than others.
Yeah.
But, like, if you look at mine was I got to basically trigger an extra upgrade without, I either moved or triggered someone else's. But so you think about that, and it's like, okay, I basically get two resources because I didn't have to pay for that space. But then, like, your income was way more than two resources So in that aspect, and here's the thing though, like I stayed in the rounds the longest the whole entire time.
Right.
So it wasn't like I wasn't managing my resources. I just, you know, I ended up getting stuck. And I think let's finish out rolls so we can kind of get into the gameplay.
You know, Stonemaier has had a history of, with Pendulum, same problem. They didn't have a balancing problem there. They had some issues with the functionality of the game.
The flippers.
Yeah, and it's like everything about the game I, again, liked except for that, and then the starting sequence having such an influence.
But the cook game... That's based on Pendulum.
That isn't based on Pendulum. First of all, it's not even Stonemaier, so you're introducing an apples and oranges comparison.
No, okay, let me rephrase. I liked the timing mechanism of that game,
it was done well.
And then in the cook game, I don't know actually
it's
what it was.
Kitchen Rush.
It was done really, really well. So I was like, yay, I got the mechanic I actually liked. And it, like,
we're reviewing like a bunch of games
here
again.
Tonight.
So it's just Stonemaier does such excellent work with their games. I just wish they put a little more effort into the testing, the playtesting, and the, you know, get it before you get it out there, make sure everything works.
Well, I mean, the question is like, okay, you know, they have to have had reviewers and playtesters.
Oh, I'm
like,
sure they did. It's just, you can't, it's difficult, especially with variable player powers. It's difficult to get everything tested thoroughly enough to know this one is balanced, this one's balanced, and they all work well together. Because you have to basically play every scenario.
Well, I mean, and not only that, though, but depending on player competency, I mean, you know, some people, you know, for example, there are certain strategies that I do better with, and then there are certain strategies that you do better with. Like, end of game scoring is like your shtick, where I'm much more of a builder, you know. So you know, and so when people test, maybe they don't always test all the aspects of the game, right?
Yeah.
So there is that piece to it, I guess.
So
but we gotta
if we're going to lump this problem into the rules, which I don't know that it really belongs there. To me, it's a gameplay problem.
Okay, well then we can put it into gameplay.
As far as the rule books, I think the rule books are excellent. I mean, to get this much complexity into the game book, the rule book, and make it 4 pages long that you can read it and get it, you know, to the table that quick.
Fair enough.
I'm going to give the rule book probably a 10.
Okay.
Because of that. Because I mean, I've never seen a game of this complexity explained in 4 pages. That's just incredible.
Yeah. All right.
So it doesn't have a cover page though. Then it would be longer.
All right. So now let's discuss gameplay. Okay. So I'm going to give so the rules are actually pretty straightforward. Okay. So, you have your civilization. You start out with two, you pick one, obviously. And that's the civilization. And depending on that civilization, it will tell you what you get every round. It's basically additional income or an additional power that comes along with it. It ranges from, like, Randy's West, as you place military down, it opens up increased income. Where mine, I got to, like, choose one of your advancement tokens, gain resources equal to the cost of advancing into its current position. So the max I could have gotten was 3 resources. I love the whole little chart here, right here, that they have. It was very, very helpful. So you start out the game, and then you take your income. Now, your income is based on the spaces that are shown on your board. Because when you start the game, all these spaces are covered up except for one. So you go through and you collect your one levels. And basically, you get 1 resource of each type, basically, at the beginning of the game, unless there's a power that alters that, which there are some that do that. All right, and so everyone takes their turn around the table. So what does the turn look like? The turn is you spend resources and you move up on one track, okay? And the 4 tracks consist of military, science, technology, and
exploration,
okay? You could end up in space and exploration, which I think is kind of fun. But
yeah.
So basically, yeah. So you spend the resources, and the resources costs are up here at the top of the track. So depending on the area that you're in, that's the cost of it. So like the first 3 spaces are always just 1 random resource. So considering that you have 4 resources on the board that you start off with, you can at least move 4 spaces at the beginning of the game if you choose those level 1 resources. So it's not like quickly ends. Like terraforming Mars, the first round, it's like, oh, I get a move. Okay, done. I spent all my money. You know, so at least that first round has a little bit of, you can do some, there's actually room to maneuver a little bit, which I greatly appreciate. And then, so that's the cost. And then the iconography is really, really key on this. So for example, military really focuses on, getting your work, your military people out across the board. Now, the thing is the initial spots that are shown, don't have any resources on them.
So not to mention they're in an island that you have where if you don't do exploration, at least in some conjunction with it to get yourself connected, you're going to run out of spaces to play.
Correct. And so I've noticed that they typically pair with the thing across the board. So military and exploration typically go really, really well together because you explore, then you know, militarize the exploration. And I think technology works really, really well.
I feel technology and science are both kind of independent. Science affects all of them, whereas technology is kind of an independent track. I agree, military and exploration kind of go hand in hand, although I spend a lot more time doing military actions than I do exploration.
Yeah, you kicked me out. I don't want to talk about it. So listen, every time I was able to get a special token, he would take it from me. Poopy head. Anyway, so... No, but your guy was strictly focused on military, versus like the science track lets you move up across different tracks. So that can be good or bad, especially, you know, but at the same time, it's like, okay, I'm paying 3 resources to go up one track somewhere else. So if I'm going up a 2 section, there was no value add. And I actually came across where it was like, okay, well, the only thing that's worth it is over there, you know, one area, and I'm not ready to trigger that yet, so I'm not ready to trigger this yet, but then I'm not ready to trigger these others. So it kind of got in a little bit of bind. But just kind of being aware of that. So the science tracks lets you basically move up other tracks. Military lets you conquer land. Exploration allows you to explore. Science or technology allows you to get technology cards, which we'll go over. So basically, when you get the technology card, you lay it on the bottom rack. And at the end of the round, you can choose to increase one of them automatically. But there are abilities, and along the technology track, you can advance them up. So that does get triggered. And then you get special benefits as they first boom. So like the first time you upgrade it, you get the resource that's related into the circle. And then when you move it to the X, then you get this particular phase. Now, I do want to point out that you get victory points based on each round. At the end of the round, what you have exposed tells you how many victory points you're going to get at the end of that round before you go into the next one. And some of those include how many technology cards you actually have in play, how many areas you control, not how many pieces are out, how many areas you control, so that matters. And then they're straight up victory points.
The big one is your territories you control on your map, which is based upon how many rows and columns you've completed. In the essence, your bingo board over here.
Then that's this piece right here. It's your capital sitting and you're trying to
This is my favorite aspect of the game, is that they've added this. It's almost like a Tetris-y type thing, which we love. And you get these cool buildings to fill it, and it's just a lot of fun playing that board.
I'm just sad because I can never fill the board.
Yeah. Well, you came really close.
I was missing like sections.
But they put little dots strategically on all the different maps in different locations to make it where you cannot play on those. There's those dead zones, although there's a few characters, a few abilities that let you break those rules. But in general, you've got to work strategically around those dots.
Yeah, and you can place over the board, but
the board, not over those dots. You cannot cover the dots.
Not over the dots, but over the board, or outside of the Sudoku board. But the problem with that is you're losing spaces that you're not covering elsewhere. So that's kind of the bummer with that. So it's not the end of world if you get this big, huge piece and you can't quite fit it. But at the same time, it sucks because... you can't fit it.
But you get perks for if you fill a square in which they have like 3x3 squares in each of the major tic-tac-toe board sections. And if you fill that section, you get a bonus resource for your...
It really is a Sudoku board because there's 9 and a 9.
Well, You're not writing numbers in it. I don't remember.
No.
So it's, I mean, you've got a major tic-tac-toe board. You've got bingo. You can call it wherever you want. It's the same thing. You're trying to cover things and make rows and columns. And ultimately, you can get a bonus for filling in a square, too. So there's, you know, this is my, like I said, my favorite aspect that they actually combined this with the track building. Everything about it, like I said, I love every individual piece of this game. Except for the variable player powers just ruining it for me.
Yeah.
Now, like I said, I enjoyed it more. Of course, I won, so that helps. But I enjoyed it more last time we played because we took out the one that I think is the most broken of the broken.
Now, I will say I've always enjoyed it. I've always enjoyed the play. I get a little sad at the end because I've never once had the futurist. nor have I, you know, no, I didn't do too bad this one. I got second place this go around, but you still kicked my butt. Mm-hmm. So in that aspect, you know, I haven't got to win, but I've always enjoyed the game. Like, even though sometimes I'm like, oh, man, I'm not going to win this. I still had fun doing it.
Yeah.
So, I think I've got to figure out how to, because I just want to reach the end of the track. There's not necessarily a bonus reaching the end of the track. I just feel there is
bonuses for reaching the end of the track because there's three end game bonuses you can get in this. One is for reaching the end of the track first, you get 15-point bonus, and you could get it second too and third if you were the
first. Right, but the problem is like it. I was expanding out my century or my errors really really long. So you guys, like, you know, I played several rounds after everyone else finished. Which is why I'm really good at Everdell. But in this case, it kind of hindered me because you guys got resources faster, so you were able to do bigger things faster, even though I had a longer game, right? So you were able to do that stuff faster than me, so it's not, you know, it's not...
Well, you can retire early. There's no reason you can't. Now, you've got to be careful because you don't want to lose resources by capping out. Because, right. you know, once you hit 8 resources, you do not get extras. That's the max.
Well, I mean, my thing is though, in the long run, I'm getting more resources. Because the more I play, I'm opening up these locations right. And able to get more resources, which prolongs my game overall. So that means I can overall do more things. I just, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's a balancing act. And that's what I like about the game. I like the fact that you have trade-offs because everything's good. I love opening up my board to get more resources. Mm-hmm. I love the fact that I get victory points, could get victory points along the way.
Yeah.
I can rush up a track and get, you know, the big buildings to put onto my board. There's a lot of different options to choose from here. And, of course, there's always the progress or development cards. I don't usually go that route, so I don't usually get many of those. But, you know, that's an option, and it paid out very well for Kevin. You know, he did with that strategy.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of ways to score points, and that's what I like. So, again, everything I like is in this game, except for the variable player powers making it a mess.
Yeah.
As far as this game, the other things you can do to get in-game bonuses are you can topple, which means conquering two areas, which is the part you didn't like of the military strategy. When you are conquering, when you connect to another player's...
Honestly, I was fine with it. I just didn't like the fact that he did it to me.
When you connect to another player's tiles, you can play and attack, in essence, where that person is. They lose that territory. So you can only have two towers in a given territory. So once you've toppled someone, there's no taking it back. So you have to build around them. It's basically, it creates a barricade for you. But if you topple two player tokens, then you get a bonus at the end for 15 points. Then the third way is by getting to the central area here on the board and placing your
pile,
which I did right away. I got up there really quick.
And then, yes, you did, and I'm making my path, and you, like, took over my stuff. Listen, he was annoying me. I think he knew I was tired.
So, I mean, I always try to get to that strategy because I think it is the easiest to pay off. But, you know, everybody does it differently. You know, and in this case, my character ability went along with what I normally play anyway, which is to rush up and try to get that central territory.
And you kicked our tail ends.
Not really. Well, it was, yeah, I guess I won pretty handily.
Yes. Let's talk about scoring now. What are you going to get this?
This is a very hard one. This is a very polarizing one. And this is what, you know, Rob and I were talking about before. Whenever we got this, is going to be an interesting one to discuss because There's so much I like about this game. I really, really wanted to. If it weren't for that problem, I probably would have given this a 10. Because it's got every aspect of games I like in it.
Wow, you like it that much?
I would have liked it that much. The Variable Player Powers brings it down for me immensely. Mm-hmm. Because there's so many issues with it. If it had been done well, then it would have been fine. But the fact that it's done poorly, and there's so many issues with the Variable Player Powers, I'm going to give it a 7.5. I'll give it a 7.5. That's where I'll end up. Because I like so much about it that it would have pushed it up much higher. But yeah, the fact that it becomes non-playable in my eyes, at least not fairly playable. You can still play the game. You just know people are going to win if they get certain factions.
Well, I mean, and I think the biggest thing was taking the futuristic out, right? Like that.
Yeah, if you took the futurists out, yeah. And just to let you know, the futurists get to start at the second tier of every track, which is a huge advantage because getting up the tracks is the main focus of the game, and it gets you to the point where you can get the bigger buildings first, and whoever gets to that top space first gets the building, and then the others don't get anything for getting those spaces except for the basic.
So basically, it's like, you know, if you start at level 2, you just, you know, in the first round, you could at least hit 2 of the buildings if you do it right. Yeah. You know, automatically, the next round, you could probably get the other 2. And then, you know, I mean, you've already set up your board. If you do it right, then, you know.
You basically locked in that you're going to max out on most all the tracks by the end of the game. And 2, you're going to get 8 of the buildings guaranteed. You know, and that's a huge advantage compared to the other
4
factions.
Of the buildings, but yeah.
No, there's 2 on each track.
Yeah, but you're not going to get all of them.
Most likely you are.
There's
3 on each track. You lose 4 of them because you can't get the one that you advanced to by the initial placement. But you have 3. You got 3 leg up on everybody else getting to each of them. So you could probably reach all of them before everybody else.
Maybe. I mean, it just depends.
Yeah.
Well, if you go up this track, you probably could.
Yes. So almost guarantees you, in my eyes, 8 of the buildings. And that is a huge advantage.
Yeah.
So that's why we don't like the Futurist. But in general, I mean, I think the game is a lot of fun if you didn't have that problem. But it, you know, they did take steps to fix it, and kudos to them for that.
Well, and they said in the new expansion they're going to also be adjusting some of that, right?
Like, I haven't heard that.
Oh, I thought that's what Rob was saying.
Rob might have said it. I don't know.
So my thing is even with the player weirdness going on, the variable powers, I still always have fun playing this game. I still have fun doing it. It's like, yeah, it's annoying that I may or may not win, or, oh, crap, you had that stupid power, and that, you know, whatever. And that part's a little bit frustrating, but I still have fun playing, and it's like, you know what, so what, I didn't win, it's not that big of a deal.
But it's not the fact that I win or don't win. It's the fact that in everybody's mind, when you play, it's not that you feel like you accomplished something by your strategy. You feel like everybody's thinking, you got the most powerful guy at the table, that's why you won.
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe when they did these, they should have, like, counted resources and figure out, okay, well, this saves you 6, this saves you 5, you know, and averaging it out.
That's probably what they did to try to figure it out. I just don't think, you can't really change some of those aspects, like the track advancement, into resources. You know, it's not a matter of adding or subtracting resources at that point. You've got a huge advantage from every aspect of the game because you get better stuff as you advance on every track. You get the advantage of getting the buildings first. There's too much to overcome with that faction. And, you know, so you, to just add on that you lose some resources is not going to balance it.
Yeah.
And, you know, they did try, so kudos to them for that. And I appreciate that. But then what happened? We played the game the other day. I played the Militants, not even listed as one that's unbalanced on that chart. No adjustment made for that. But yet everybody sat there and said, your ability was better than all of ours the entire game.
Well, no. So here's the thing, though. I think that one did come up in one of our playthroughs, and we did think that one was a little more powerful than the other ones that were played. I mean, all right. So I do think you're right in the fact that, yes, that, you know, it brings into question that, okay, oh, you won because of your player power, not because Your actual play style or things like that. And I do think that that could probably get annoying if you win and people are like, oh, you won with that little hashtag or whatever. And that could get annoying. Yeah. But I still have a lot of fun playing this game. So for me, I'm going to give an 8 with the caveat of if I don't feel like winning, it's fine. Now, if I feel like winning and I want to go at it, this is probably not the game.
That's probably right? The thing is I always want to win or I always feel like winning. So.
Yeah, I know, but if I always felt like winning, you'd get mopey because I would win all the time. So it's really...
handicapping yourself when you play me in this game.
Come on, I crochet and do craft projects while I play a game. That's you don't think you that's have a
attention deficit disorder.
That is also true. So I'm going to give it an 8 with the caveat of I can't feel competitive when I play this game because I'll get picky about the player powers. But I still enjoy this game. I still have a lot of fun, okay? So even though it's a little screwed up, I still have a blast.
So what's your score?
8, I said.
Oh, 8, okay.
I said it like 3 times. He's not listening to me. He tuned me out.
Attention deficit disorder when you...
You are totally... Yeah, when I'm talking, yes, you do. All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We had an absolute blast today, and hopefully you'll come hang out with us again. All right. Bye.